Hello, in this video we're going to be making a website that gives you a visual representation of how old you actually are. We will be using a Python library called Flask for our backend and HTML, CSS, and JavaScript for our frontend. Now first off, why should you learn Flask? Flask is useful if you want to create a really simple website or API, since Flask makes creating websites extremely easy and convenient. In addition, you get to have a Python backend, so if you already have some Python code written and you want to implement that code in a website without rewriting everything from scratch in another language, using Flask would be a good choice. Okay, let's get straight into it. So first off, we create a file named app.py. Then, we import these Flask submodules from Flask. We will be learning about each of these in this video. Next, we import a built-in Python module called datetime, which will actually help us in calculating the age based on a given birthday. To initialize our app, we call the Flask function and pass in a variable called name, which is a default variable representing the name of our program. And then, we do @app.route/, which is known as a Python decorator. We are essentially telling Python when Flask detects that a specific page of the website is loaded, then the function defined right below the app.route decorator should be executed. The function home that we defined is going to manage the homepage of our website. For now, we're just going to make the function return hello world. Next, we see that if the variable name is equal to main, then we run our app in debug mode. The if statement that we defined is just a good practice to ensure that we call the app.run function only when we directly run the app.py program. When we run our program and open the link that our website is running on, then we see a page that says hello world. Our next step is creating a templates folder where we'll be putting all our HTML files. In this folder, we create a file named index.html. We add in some boilerplate HTML code. We then create a form with three input elements. The first element is for entering the birthday, the second is for entering the time of birth, and the third is for the submit button. In our form tag, we say method equals post to send our form data to our Flask server once the submit button is clicked by the user. We're not going to work too much on the looks of the website, but to make the website a little bit neater, we're just going to add some simple CSS. We use CSS Flex to center our form properly in the middle of the page. Then, to tell Flask to use our HTML file for the homepage, instead of returning hello world, we are going to return the return value from the render template function and pass in the HTML file into the function. Remember how we have all the HTML files in the templates folder? Yeah, we did that because the render template function looks for the HTML files in the templates folder by default. Now, we can run our program and see our homepage. Notice how when we click the submit button, our website says method not allowed. The method that it is referring to is the post method that we defined in our HTML form. To allow the post method, we need to make some changes to our Python code. In the Python decorator, we add in a methods argument and assign it to a list which contains all the methods that we want to allow. The get and post methods are HTTP methods. The get method is used to get data from a server, and the post method is used to send data to a server. In the case of our form, when we click the submit button, we are sending data to our Flask server, so we used the post method. We say if request.method equals to post, or in other words, if we got the form data, Then, we store the boat date and the boat time from the form in their respective variables. We can also print these two variables for debugging purposes. Next, we can just test our code. This time, when we click the submit button, we don't see any errors because we allowed the post method. And when we go back to our terminal window, we also see that the boat date and the boat time are getting printed. What this means is that the data from our form is successfully getting sent to our Flask server. Next, we're going to make it such that when the user clicks on the submit button, the website redirects them to a new page. And this page will visually show you how many days, weeks, and years old you are. We can call this page the stats page. So first we do app.routes/stats and create a function named stats. So when we redirect to the stats page, we're going to pass in the boat date and the boat time as query strings, which I'll go over in a bit. But to get our form data from these query strings, we use a request.args.get function. Now, we need to figure out exactly how many days old the user is based on the boat date and the boat time that the user entered. To do this, we're going to use the datetime module that we imported in the beginning. We then create a datetime object for the birthday using the datetime stripped time function, which uses a string and a given string format to come up with the datetime object. And we also create a datetime object for the current time using datetime's noun function. Now we just need to find the difference in time between these two dates and times. The datetime module makes doing this really easy because we can simply subtract the two datetime objects to get the time between. To get the seconds of this elapsed time, we just do elapsed time.totalSeconds and store that in seconds. And we can then easily find the days. Now all we need to do is return the return value from the render template function, and we pass in the name of our HTML file and the days variable as an argument. We do this to send the days from our backend to our frontend. Now, we need to make our website redirect to the stats page when the user clicks the submit button. To do this, we grab the URL for the stats page and pass in the URL into the redirect function to redirect us to the stats page. But notice how we also pass in the birthday and the birth time variables into the URL for function. The URL for function then returns a URL with the birthday and the birth time as query strings. For example, a URL returned by this function would be in this kind of format. We do this to easily send data from the form in the homepage to the stats page. Next, we can just add a line of code to print these and see what our program does when we run it. Okay, we do get an error when we click the submit button, which is expected because we didn't create the stats.html file yet. But if we go to our terminal window and scroll for a bit, we can find that the days gets printed, which is great. So now we just need to create the stats.html file in the templates folder. We can start off with adding some boilerplate HTML code. Now, you might have noticed that I have two curly braces around the word days in the title tag. This is actually Jinja2 syntax, and Jinja2 is a template engine that Flask uses. So I basically used this syntax to grab days from our backend. Because remember how we passed in days into the render template function? Yeah, so we're using that variable in our HTML file. So our stats page was going to have boxes, and each box would represent a day or a week or a year. So to draw these boxes in a specific way, we can create the drawBoxes function, which takes in the box dimensions, the x and y gap or distance between two boxes, the initial y position of the box, the number of boxes we want to draw, and the change in sizes of the boxes after drawing each box. We create a for loop that iterates count number of times. And before we draw any boxes, we check if the current iteration is the last iteration of the for loop. If it is, then we set the box width to a fraction of the initial box width. And we do this because if we have, for example, days as a decimal, like 1.5, then we should show 1.5 boxes. So the last box should have a width that is half of the width of the other boxes. And we say if the x position of the box is greater than the screen width minus the box width, then we set the x position to 0 and increase the y position, because we would start a new row of boxes. The x and y variables will be defined as global variables outside the function. We then increase the box width and the box height by the size change. And then we can just draw the box to the screen. And now, to set the x position for the next box, we add the box width and x gap to the x label. Now, once we finish drawing all the boxes, we increase the y position by box height, and we do ctx.stroke to make all our drawings visible on the screen. So we created a canvas element in our HTML, and we're going to draw everything on the canvas. So to do this, we grab the canvas element using the getElementById function. And then we use the getContext function to get the context which we use in the function that we defined above. We store the screen width and the screen height, and we set the canvas width and the canvas height. We're going to have two titles on our page, so we set the two titles sizes in the respective variables. Now, we just store the days, set the initial x and y positions, and set the font so that we can use the full text function and display text to the screen. Then we increment the y position by 30, and then we call the drawBoxes function. So for this set of boxes, since each box represents a day, we can have each box have a small width and height of 10 pixels, and the gap between the boxes in the x and y directions can be 2 pixels, and we're going to have the same number of boxes as the number of days, and we're not going to have any changes in sizes. After drawing the boxes, we increment the y position again and set the x position to 0. And then we do a similar thing as we did before, but for weeks. So we just draw the text to the screen and call the function, but except this time, we set count equals days divided by 7. Now finally, we need to display the years. For count, we're going to say days divided by 365 and set size change to 1. Then we'll also be displaying a quote, just saying how precious time is and stuff. In our CSS, we set the overflow x to hidden and the margin to 0% for the HTML and the body. And to make things a little bit nicer, we set the canvas margin to 10 pixels. Also, I accidentally created the stats.html file outside the templates folder, so let's just like move that. Okay, so we're finally done with all the code for this project. Now we can just run our code and see everything come together. Okay, I'm just going to select a random date and a random time. Cool, so now we have a visual representation of how old someone is based on a given birthday. Okay, so we're done with the video. The GitHub link to the code for this project will be posted in the description. If you found this video helpful, please like and subscribe and comment down below to help the YouTube algorithm find this video, you know? And if you have any suggestions for how I can improve my videos or video ideas for the future, feel free to let me know. Okay, that's it. See you.